Today is September 6, 2015. It is Labor Day weekend. This is our last Sunday service at the drive-in, Melody Cruise Inn, until next Memorial Day. We have our 8 o'clock service, Memorial Day through Labor Day, at the Melody Drive-In on East 40 East of Springfield. It would be our pleasure if you would join us next year when we start up again. This was our 59th year at the drive-in. Next year will be the 60th that we'll be celebrating. Today is the pet blessing. The last service of the season is always the pet blessing. We have members of the congregation and anyone, visitors coming to bring their pets, cats, dogs, anything you have. And they'll be blessed by the minister, Pastor John Pollock. Our outside service, you sit in your car, come as you are, be comfortable. We have free coffee and donuts in the before the service starts. You can sit in your car or bring a chair, sit outside of your car. You hear the service on your radio the way you would do a drive-in. Lutheran Church drive-in service. This is September 6th, 2015. This is the last drive-in service of the season. This is Labor Day weekend. Starting next week, we'll be at the church, laid out for the 8 and 10:30 service. Drive-in service is from Memorial Day to Labor Day. So join us with our service today.
Thank you. those who are fearful of heart. Be strong, do not fear. Fear is your God. He will come with vengeance. With terrible recompense he will come and save you. Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame shall leap like deer, and the tongue of the speechless sing for joy. For waters shall break forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand shall become a pool, and the thirsty ground springs of water. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now our second reading is from 2 James, and there's quite a few verses here. My brothers and sisters, do you with your acts of favoritism really believe in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ? For if a person with gold rings and in fine clothes comes into your temple, and in clothes, dirty clothes, you show them. If you take notice of the one wearing the fine clothes and say, have a seat here, please. While to the one who's poor, you say, stand there, or sit at my feet. Have you not made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my beloved brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen the poor in the world to be rich in faith and to be heirs of the kingdom that he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. Whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable. Said, you shall not commit adultery, also said, you shall not murder. Now you do not commit adultery, but if you murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so act as those who are to be judged with the law of liberty. For judgment will be without mercy to anyone who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. What good is it, my brothers and sisters? You say you have faith, but do not have works. Can faith save you? If your brother or sister is faint and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. Word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Of the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 7th chapter, glory to you, O Lord. Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there, and he could not escape notice. But a woman, whose little daughter had an unclean spirit, immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syro-Phoenician origin. She begged him to cast a demon out of her daughter. He said to her, let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. But she answered her, sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. Then he said to her, for saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter. So she went home, found the child lying on the bed and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private, away from the crowd, put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then looking up to heaven, he sighed, and he said to him, Ephatha, that is, be opened. And immediately his ears were opened. His tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. And Jesus ordered them to tell no one. But the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We now affirm our faith with the affirmation on page 2 in your worship book. We believe that God is the author of all life in heaven and on earth. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord of life. He died on the cross to defeat the power of death and was raised again to bring resurrection and life to all who trust in him. He lives and rules among us now and for all eternity. We believe the Spirit of God is alive among us, daily giving us new birth, filling us with grace and truth, and bringing us into one life with each other in harmony with the whole creation. We praise God for life. Thank you, Mick. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. There was a bank in Chicago at which a young man from Boston was applying for a job. So the bank in Chicago wrote back to Boston, to the investment firm the young man had worked at in Boston, asking for a recommendation. The investment house was all too happy to send a recommendation, and in the letter, they talked about how this young man's father was a Cabot, his mother was a Lowell, his grandparents and aunts and uncles and great-grandparents and all his relatives were members of the fine and best families of Boston and could trace themselves all the way back to the Mayflower. So they recommended him highly. Well, a few days later, that Boston investment firm was surprised to receive a letter back from the Chicago bank saying that their letter was totally inadequate. They said, quote, "We are not planning on breeding this young man, just using him for work. A name can often bring you special privileges. When we review the history of our nation, we can see where certain family names have stood out throughout history and that descendants of those people oftentimes have been given opportunities that you or I might not have because our name was not the same. Talking about names like Kennedy, Rockefeller, Morgan, DuPont, to name just a few. And I am sure that in Springfield, there are probably certain old family names of original business people and bankers and so forth that would probably bring some type of recognition. Just like when I was growing up and living in Lexington and Louisville, there were certain old Southern family names and those descendants automatically receive some kind of privileges or would automatically be voted for in an election because they were a whatever. Well, in the world, oftentimes your social status means an awful lot. And you can receive all types of recognition because of your social status. That's the way the world operates. But when it comes to the church, such an attitude should never be found. But unfortunately, what we see happen is that oftentimes this same attitude creeps into the church, where people are recognized or fawned over or given special positions or so forth, not because the Holy Spirit is calling them to that position, not because the congregation feels the Holy Spirit calling them to ask that person to do such and such, but it's because of their wealth or their power or their connections or their education or their social status. And it is this idea of showing preference or what we would commonly refer to as favoritism. This is what St. James is addressing in our second reading for today, or what he refers to as the sin of partiality. Now, before we look at our sermon text and what St. James is saying, we need to give you a few facts about the epistle to James. The epistle has, throughout the history of the church, oftentimes been criticized because very rarely, if ever, does he use the name of Jesus Christ. He refers to Jesus, he uses terms like Lord and so forth, but he never talks about the passion of Jesus Christ. He never talks about Jesus' atoning death upon the cross. He doesn't really go into the theology of the Christian faith, as do St. Peter and St. Paul and St. John and Jude and the epistles that they left us. Instead, James, the epistle of James, deals not with theological matters, but with practical issues, with the type of things that arise in the congregation day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year, that can affect the smooth operation of that congregation or cause conflict within the congregation. Some scholars think that the letter of James is actually a sermon that James gave, and that in this sermon he was addressing practical issues, such issues as impatience, as a failure to do what you know is right, favoritism, apathy, and selfishness. So St. James, instead of bringing up the theology of the church, which St. Paul does so often, St. James seems to be writing to a group of Christians who are already well grounded in the faith. They know the theology. They're not practicing works righteousness. They're not saying you have to become a Jew first in order to be a Christian. They're not arguing over food sacrificed to idols. They're not talking about keeping the Jewish laws. They know what the gospel of Jesus Christ is all about, but now they need to have instruction on the everyday running of the congregation. And so in our reading today, St. James, as I said, is dealing with this sin of partiality, and how the sin of partiality, when allowed to creep into the church, can cause nothing but conflict and despair. He wastes no time in dealing with the problem. Verse 1 of chapter 2, he says, "My brothers and sisters, show no partiality as you hold the faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory." Show no partiality. The word partiality means to lift up someone unduly because of who they are. It means to be unduly influenced by someone because of their social status, their power, or their money. It means to make an unfair act of judgment based on worldly criteria. And that is one of those problems that affect the church. Too often, we make decisions by worldly criteria, not spiritual criteria. Now, obviously, when it comes to the financial matters of the church, we have to use basically worldly criteria. The church, just like any institution, cannot spend more than what it's taking in. It cannot go off on projects doing some kind of building or whatever when the money's not there. That's foolishness. But when it comes to the other matters of the church, the vision of the church, the future of the church, the ministry of the church, worldly criteria are not supposed to be used, but spiritual criteria. We're supposed to look to Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And as St. James tells us in this letter, as he continues to talk about practical matters, at the end he does stress the importance of the confession of sins and the importance of taking problems to God in prayer and asking for God's help. So not turning to the world and their criteria. So do have no partiality, show no partiality. Do not be influenced by the world's criteria, he's saying. And then he gives us an example of how bad that can be. He gives the example that two men come into worship. One is a rich man, fine robes, golden rings on his fingers. Everybody fawns all over him. They give him the best seat in the worship space. Everybody wants to know who he is. Then a poor man comes in, and the poor man is ignored. And the poor man finally is told, oh, go stand up there by the wall or sit at my feet like you're my child or you're my pet. And so St. James is saying, as Christians, we cannot treat one another like that. That Jesus Christ died on the cross for all people, no matter what their social status is. That Jesus Christ died for all people, no matter how much education they have, no matter how much money they have, power they have, connections they have, their social status, how much they don't have, Jesus died for us all. And as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, we are to relate to one another equally. He then says, or makes the accusation, that the sin of partiality leads to then made distinctions among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts. He is saying that you are guilty of making class distinctions. As St. Paul tells us, within the community of faith, there's neither Jew nor Greek, male nor female, slave or free. But instead, we're all one in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so those worldly criteria for doing things are not to be in the church. Oftentimes, as St. James points out, all the times it's the poor who have the greatest faith. It is the poor who might have the greatest spiritual leadership possibilities. And so you should not make distinctions. You should not make class distinctions among people. If you're familiar with the Indian religion, meaning the nation of India, of Hinduism, you know that in Hinduism they have a caste system. You are put into classes. And the lower classes cannot intermingle with the higher classes. And the higher classes don't intermingle with the lower classes. And that is why the Christian faith has upset India and its society so much ever since it's been there, because of the gospel of everybody being the same. Of not showing any partiality. That God is no respecter of persons, but that everybody is the same to him, no matter your rank, no matter your position, or lack of. And so, with no partiality, comes not making distinctions, because distinctions bring about judgment. Bringing about judgment on somebody, counting them as worthy or non-worthy. It's not up to the church to make that distinction. And then he tells us that we are not to show dishonor to those who are poor or less educated or have less power or influence or connection. But instead he tells us, you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name by which you were called? If you really fulfill the royal law, according to the scriptures, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Remember the night of Jesus' betrayal in the upper room. that Jesus expanded on this second great commandment of loving your neighbor as yourself. He said that within the community of faith, that extended further into a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. How much did Jesus Christ love us? Enough to sacrifice himself on the cross. Loved us so much, he was willing to do whatever it took, which was his death on the cross, in order that we might have a right relationship with God, that we might have the forgiveness of sins, that we might have that promise of everlasting life. All this through his death upon the cross, which he willingly went to the cross. He willingly gave up his life, as the scriptures tell us, as he took that breath and last breath and said, Father, into your hand I commend my spirit, and gave his spirit back up to God. Willingly, voluntarily, his life was not ripped away from him. His life was not taken from him, but he gave it up voluntarily so that we could be his own. And so we are to love one another as he loves us. Be willing to sacrifice. Be willing to give up for the betterment of the fellowship. When St. James reminds us of loving our neighbor as ourselves, he reminds us also about what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 7, verse 1, when Jesus said, judge not, or you'll be judged as you have judged others. Now, enemies of the church, or critics of the church, have taken those words of Jesus and tried to say, see, Christians have no right to say anything about social issues or about the morals of society or whatever. But that's not true. When Jesus said, judge not, you be not judged, he was talking about us judging somebody's worth before God, or somebody judging somebody's worth within the community of faith. He was not saying that Christians cannot be judges making decisions on legal cases. He is not saying that the church cannot put forth a standard of a high bar for the standard of morals by which we live by. But what we were saying is that we were not to be like the Pharisees, who looked down their noses at everybody who wasn't like them, and who said that everybody who wasn't like them was going to hell, Jew or Gentile, and that they were not worthy in the eyes of God. Jesus is emphasizing the fact that we are all important in the eyes of God. When James says that we are dishonoring the poor person by treating them like they are, that word dishonor literally means to treat shamefully or to despise someone. James is echoing our Lord Jesus Christ's teaching that we are not to despise anyone because of their race, their creed, their color, their origin, their gender, whatever. That we are to love as we have been loved. That God grants us mercy, and so we are to grant mercy to others. As we have been forgiven, we are to forgive others. As we have been loved, we are to love. There's an old parable that comes from Persia about a Persian prince who was invited to a banquet. So he decided he would dress up in shabby clothes. And he went to the banquet looking like a poor man, and people ignored him and they elbowed him out of the way, and he never could make his way up to the table to pick up anything to eat, and eventually he had to leave. So he goes back to his palace and he changes and puts on his fanciest gold thread robe and his fanciest jewels on his hands and wrist and so forth, and he returns to the feast. And as he walks in the door, everybody parts out of his way so that he can go up to the table. The host runs up to him and says, "Welcome, my lord prince. What would you like to eat?" The prince looks at the host and he holds out his hand in a mocking, sarcastic tone, shaking the jewels that are all in his fingers and the bands around his wrist, said, "Lord Jules, what would you like to eat?" And then he grabs hold of his robe and he looks at it and he says, "Lord Robe, what would you like to eat?" And the host said, "Lord Prince, what are you doing?" And he responded, "You welcomed my clothes and my jewels, so your welcome should be to them. You did not welcome me." See, when he came, he was the same person. But when he came in shabby clothes, no one wanted any part of him. When he came as the prince, they fawned all over him. That is how the world operates. St. James is telling us today that is not the way of the church. We are to greet all people the same. That as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, as the fellowship of Jesus Christ, we do not make shallow, temporary judgments based on social status, power, wealth, connections, whatever. But when one is a fellow believer, we are to greet them and welcome them, no matter their status. So as the followers of our Lord Jesus Christ, let us show no partiality. Let us not be judgmental. And let us never dishonor those who seem to be less fortunate than we are. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now sing, "We Praise You, O God." After the ushers have been to your car, if you have a pet to be blessed, I ask that you come forward and line up in front of me down here on the pavement right in front of the pulpit here as we sing, "We Praise You, O God," page 5 in your worship book.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God,
and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Almighty God, in giving us dominion over the things on earth, you made us fellow workers in your creation. Give us wisdom and reverence so to use the resources of nature, that no one may suffer from our abuse of them, and that generations yet to come may continue to praise you for your bounty, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the words of King David in Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and infants, you have established strength because of your foes, to still the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heaven, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you care for him? You have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hand. You put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of heaven and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, in your love you created us in your image and made us stewards of the animals that live in the skies, the earth, and the sea. Bless us in our care for our pets and animals. Help us recognize your power and wisdom in the variety of creatures that live in our world. And hear our prayer for all that suffer over work, hunger, and ill treatment. Protect your creatures and guard them from all evil, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord Almighty order our deeds, our days, and our deeds in his peace. Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever.
Thank you.
The only can.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever.
He wishes he wasn't here.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen.
There she is.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless and keep you now and forever. Amen.
So you brought two of them. You don't get the real effect without the sound.
That was the congregation's pets. We have the pet blessing once a year, Labor Day weekend.
Thank you.
love of the Lord Jesus draw us to himself. May the power of our Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. May the joy of the Lord Jesus fill our souls. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon us and remain with us now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us now sing the hymn, O Beautiful for Spacious Skies, page 6 in your worship folder, our bulletin. And after the singing of the hymn, we'll have our final comments for this drive-in singing service. Page 6. Come to the close of our drive-in season for 2015, and as always, we give thanks to God our Heavenly Father and His Son our Lord Jesus Christ, who through the Holy Spirit have enabled us to worship together this summer. Next, we give thanks to Phil Checkers and his family for the continued use of the Melody Cruise in theater these past 59 years, and we look forward to continued use in the future. We also thank Mark Booth, Mr. Checker's assistant, for all of his assistance and being our liaison to the person to go to whenever we have any kind of problems here at the drive-in. Also, we want to thank all those who enable this service to be conducted each week. Our thanks to Bill Corliss, Larry Thompson, Ben O'Dell, Pat Taylor, Stephen Marilyn Pyers, Sharon Thompson, Sandy Kramer, Cindy Pearson, Tim McCullough, Greg Nolte, Vicki Perks, Becky Demetroff, Harvey Baker, Alicia Willis, Pam Riggs, Lisa Harinko, and Jeff Dunmar. Also to all those who read each week, to those who helped me with the communion service, and to anyone whom I may have left out, forgive me and know that your help was greatly appreciated. And finally, my thanks to all of you who loyally each week support this ministry and enable us to have a reason for being here. Your support throughout these years is greatly appreciated, and we hope to see it continue in the future. Next Sunday, this 8 a.m. service will move back to the sanctuary at 27 North Wittenberg, and we invite you to join us for worship then or at 10:30. For those of you who have your own church but join us for these summer services, we thank you for your support, and with all of you and the members of St. John's, I look forward to seeing you next year when we celebrate the 60th anniversary of this community drive-in church. May God bless you. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Have a safe week, holiday weekend. Thanks be to God.
That concludes the drive-in service for September 6th, Labor Day weekend, and have a safe and healthy weekend. Goodbye.